So this idea of complementary identical strands is what we have in DNA, and the complementary double strands pairs up every T with an A. Every T in one strand is going to be paired up with an A in another strand, and likewise every G in one strand is going to pair up with a C. And so once we set the sequence of nucleobases, then we automatically define the sequence in the corresponding strand, G with C and A with T. Now it turns out, this is a small detail that isn't so obvious, that these two strands in the DNA double helix run in opposite directions to one another, and so the bottom strand, the 5 prime to 3 prime direction, is from left to right. In the top strand, the 5 prime to 3 prime direction is from right to left. And if we take this stick figure and put some real bonds and atoms associated with it, what we have is a structure that looks like this. The sugar phosphate backbone ends up making what looks to be the strands of a ladder, where the rungs of the ladder are the nucleobases that are paired together. Now, these nucleobases, whether there's two hydrogen bonds or three, will depend on whether we're talking about A with T or three would be G with C, but these base pairs are basically planar sets of atoms that are adjacent to one another as close as can be. Remember, and write this down, that the van der Waal radius of carbon is 1.7 angstroms. And so 2 times 1.7 is 3.4, and that's basically as close as two carbon atoms would come together. And so these planes that are the base pair nucleobases of nucleic acids are stacked together as tight as they can be. Now the actual structure of the double helix takes these two strands that you see and puts a twist into it. Here's the structure in space-filling representation. You can see that the diameter of the double helix is about 20 angstroms. There's one complete turn that's made every 34 angstroms or so. So you can see that the strand that starts here on the right, ends here on the right, after transmitting about 34 angstroms, just a little bit longer than that. And so with 3.4 angstroms separating them, there's about 10 or 11 base pairs in making up one turn of the double helix. Here's the space-filling model, and you can see that these planes of nucleobases are packed about as close as they can be together. And on the outside of this, we have these sugar phosphate groups, the very polar sugar phosphate groups, so that if we look at this structure from the top view down, our eye positioned there, then what we have is an amphiphilic structure. The hydrophobic nucleobases form the center, and on the outside we have this highly charged sugar phosphate backbone, and so with water molecules all around on the outside, we have water molecules engaged with this highly hydrophilic sugar phosphate backbone and screened from the interior, which is a very hydrophobic set of atoms. And that's important because in order for those hydrogen bond pairing to take place between nucleobases, water must be shed from that interior. Water has hydrogen bond donors and acceptors and would interfere with the natural base pairing that takes place in the nucleoacid base pairing. And so by having this hydrophobic interior, water is not going to interfere and hydrogen bond to the nucleobases. So what's the mechanism of replication that Watson and Crick recognize? Well, having complementary base pairs, basically what one sees is the structure shown here. And all this, by the way, this replication process is enzyme catalyzed by the DNA polymerase enzyme that you saw at the very beginning of webcast 38.1. In blue, I've colored the parent strands, and so you can see the two parent strands are unraveling here. In yellow are the daughter strands, and so those are being generated by the DNA polymerase. Now, they're complementary, and so every blue will match its complementary strand in yellow, and so at the end of this process, one DNA double helix is converted into two identical double helices that result from what's known as semi-conservative replication. And that simply means that one of the strands in the new DNA molecule was from the original molecule, and the new and there's a new strand that's formed in the resulting new DNA molecule as well. The strands are grown in the 5' to 3' direction, and so for the strand on the left, that's continuously made because that's the 5' to 3' direction. Whereas the strand on the right is synthesized in fragments. Actually, it's synthesized from the bottom up in fragments that then have to be strung together with ligase enzymes. And I've already mentioned that the resulting new strands of DNA double helix that will be transmitted into the next generation of the cell are exactly identical, but one of those strands from that double helix was an original parent strand, and one of them was newly synthesized.